Good morning, everyone. So let's start off our Lenten time in favorite hymns with 2088. Lord, I lift your name on high. Just tells the whole story. Lord, I lift your name on high, number 2088. So we have a request from one of our shut-ins, Miss Donna, who always loves to hear us sing in the morning before our service. So she would love to hear the Old Rugged Cross. I know it's one of a favorite anyway. So let's do the first two verses of the Old Rugged Cross, and that will take us into worship time this morning. The Old Rugged Cross.
Oh, I'm sorry, I can't.
526, maybe? Is that right? Sorry. Wow. Sorry, I haven't been here. 504.
It's a blessing to have you here today. I pray that each one of you will feel God's presence and God's love, because we have a God that desires to have a relationship with us, that is real, that is personal, And what a blessing it is to be in the house of the Lord today. Does anyone have any announcements? Are there any announcements? All right, Lisa has one.
I just want to say thank you to all of those that stepped up last week at the crafts at Kings of the Kingdom. I know it stressed 6 or 7 or 8 adults, as well as the kids. And I just want to say thank you, Pastor, for showing up today, because I wasn't sure you were going to.
Now you know why I dropped out of Scouts. I couldn't tie knots.
I was just going to say that tomorrow is Ed's birthday, and we're glad he's having a birthday.
All right, yeah.
Happy birthday, Ed.
Friday is World Day of Prayer, and our ceremony here will be is sponsored by Church Women United, and that's the Methodist, Presbyterian, and Catholic Ladies. And we'll have lunch here. Bring a sack lunch at noon. Speaker will be Randy Ninke, and it's on caring families. And then we'll take up a free will donation, and that will go to the caring families. We hope to keep it around an hour. So please come.
All right. And that is Friday, at noon.
We have a meeting Thursday at the Pines, our UMW meeting.
And UMW Thursday evening at the Pines. And you guys will be discussing Holy Week. That's just right around the corner. Are there any others?
Andy said I always have something to say. It's because I have a lot to make up for. I haven't been here for a while. I just wanted to say thanks so much for the prayers and cards and food. Kyle is doing well after his knee replacement surgery. So he's up and around and driving himself, which I love, so I don't have to be the chauffeur. We're quite a pair right now, though, because he's chauffeured me as much as I've chauffeured him. So I continue to have some struggles, but I'm feeling a little better and I'm cautiously optimistic, but do have an appointment with a neurosurgeon coming up later this month. So just continue to keep us in your prayers. Thank you.
Thank you, Tammy, and we will keep you all in our prayers. Are there any others? Well, God is good.
All the time.
And all the time. All right. What a blessing. Before we greet one another, let us go to the Lord in prayer. I'm going to ask you to open your hands, bow your heads, and open your hearts and minds. Let us go to the Lord today. Gracious God, we thank you for this day that you have made. We thank you again for the opportunity to worship you and praise you and just draw near to your very presence. And dear Lord, what a blessing that is. But I have to admit, I don't always take advantage of it. There's times my focus isn't on you, Lord. There's times I'm holding on to the busyness of this world. Anxiety or brokenness. Things I need to do or things I've left undone. But dear Lord, we weren't meant to carry it. 700 times in your word you tell us to come to you. So I pray today, if there's anyone that is holding on and carrying things that they don't have to, they'd allow you to work today. They'd allow you to loosen the grips, the things we're so tightly holding on to, that we would truly surrender it. Lay it at the foot of the cross. Give it to the one that can do all things. Give it to the one that is not limited. Now, gracious God, we have empty, open hands that we can receive the blessings that you have for each one of us. We have empty, open hands to receive your love, your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness, your strength, your power. And gracious God, you have chosen to use us to make a difference right where we live. That others can receive that love, that grace, that mercy, that forgiveness that we have received from you, that we would give to them. and what a blessing it is. Also, gracious God, there may be someone today that needs a special touch. Maybe they need a healing touch. Maybe they just need to hear their name. Maybe they need to know that they are loved, that they are forgiven, that you will never leave them nor forsake them. You are right there in their presence. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name. And all of God's kids say, amen. Now let us take this time and greet each other in the love of Christ, please.
Blessed are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord.
Who seek God with their whole heart.
Who also do no wrong, but walk in the Lord's ways.
You have been in your precepts to be kept diligently.
Oh, that my ways may be steadfast in keeping your statutes. I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your righteous ordinances.
I will observe your statutes, O forsake me not.
Gracious God, we come before you today. We just thank you and praise you for your love for each and every one. You have always loved us and you always will. Dear Lord, I pray that we would bring our prayers to you because you tell us to bring all prayers to you, our concerns, our blessings, our petitions. Dear Lord, we lift up those that are going through treatment. We pray for your healing hand. For those that are recovering from surgery, dear Lord, we pray for that continual healing. For those that are waiting for appointments, dear Lord, we pray for direction and guidance and that you would just reveal to the doctors exactly what needs to be done. Dear Lord, we thank you for birthdays. We thank you for anniversaries. We also lift up, dear Lord, those that are grieving loss of loved ones. dear Lord, minister to them. And we thank you that the hope that we have in you. Because, dear Lord, not even the very worst thing that could ever happen to us because of Christ isn't the last thing. So, dear Lord, just minister to each and every heart today. For those concerns or joys that may not have been expressed, you know each one of them. And we just lift them up to you. I thank you again for this day, for this time. Just minister to each and every heart. I thank you again for your forgiveness. And dear Lord, what a blessing it is to know that we are loved, that we are forgiven, and by your grace that we are empowered. Dear Lord, to continually to reach out and make a difference in this world that we live in. We do pray for direction and guidance for our country. Dear Lord, I thank you again. Now, gracious God, we come to you in a prayer that Jesus taught the disciples. And I know it, for many it is words that we know by heart. But I also pray by your grace that we would live out each word. When we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done,
on earth
as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our
trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom,
the power,
and the glory forever.
Amen.
Now at this time, let us sing the hymn, He Touched Me, and you'll find that on in the hymnal 367 or on the screen, He Touched Me. At this time, you may be seated, and with the young disciples, please come forward. All right. Okay. How are you today? What have you made?
Evelyn made it.
Oh, Evelyn made it. Okay. All right. That's nice that she shared with you, isn't it? Today, I'm going to talk about purpose. And it's a big word. And purpose, can you say it? Do you know what it is? What is it?
Purpose.
Purpose, okay. Purpose. All right. You know, and God has made us. He's given us different gifts and talents. And he wants us to share our love for others and let others know that God loves them. God loves you. Do you tell that to people? How do you do it? How is different ways, though? I know you say God loves you, and there's nothing you can do about it. But, and that is true, right? Because God always does love us. What are some things that you can do to show that love?
Daddy's always in your mind, and it makes you be.
Yeah, and then we can pray. That's right. What are some of the things that maybe you guys can do to show people that they're important? How can you do that? Okay. Well, that's okay. Think about it. How about you, Brooke? What can you do to show that people are important? Yeah, Jesus lives with you and is in your mind. Yeah, that's right. What do you think? Okay. What do you guys think? You know, on Jesus' last night, on the night that he was betrayed, on the Passover meal, they've been practicing that to remember that. It was a 7-day festival. And they've been practicing it for about 1,400 years. And then Jesus did something different. Could you believe they were arguing who was the greatest among them? Who had the best seat in the house? Who was going to get to sit by Jesus? Can you believe they argued about that? They did. So what do you think Jesus did about it? Jesus is in your mind and is with you even when we're asleep. That is right. And what'd you say? He started washing their feet because, why did he start washing their feet? Why? Because their feet were dirty. That is right. And no one else washed them, right? All right. How would you like it if I washed your feet? You would be happy. All right. Okay. Wouldn't you all be happy?
Yeah.
Or would some of you be self-conscious that I forgot to clip my toenails? All right. Okay. All right. But anyway, why do you think their feet were dirty? Because of the roads?
Yeah.
Because they didn't have cars back then, did they? And that was the least thing that you could do. I mean, people back in those days would either been slaves or the lowest of servants. But Jesus showed that each person was important, and then he washed their feet. And you know what? Even some of the people weren't even nice to Jesus. There was going to be one that was going to betray him. You think he skipped his feet? No, he washed them. How about those that were about ready to abandon him? You think he washed their feet?
Yeah.
Yeah, all right. And also it shows us that, you know, life can be pretty messy, right? Things can be pretty dirty, but we're to come along others and care for them, right? And do somersaults. I couldn't do that very well.
I can do a big somersault.
You can do a big somersault. Well, how about if I just do a big prayer? Okay? Would that be all right? All right. Okay. Well, gracious God, thank you for loving us. And thank you for how you have given us different gifts and how you're there for us and given us different talents. And dear Lord, that we would show that love to everyone because you love everyone. In Jesus' precious name, amen. All right. Okay. You guys want some cookies? Or Smarties? Okay.
Children, all the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white, they are proud.
And now at this time, we will be singing Make Me a Servant. We're going to do that twice from The Faith We Sing, and we'll find that on 2176 or also on the hymnal or also on screen. Please come forward as we receive our offering. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this opportunity. As we join you in ministry, knowing that all good things come from heaven above, knowing that you're going to bless this offering, that it's going to further your kingdom here in Ellsworth and throughout the world, that people will hear the good news of Jesus Christ, of his life, death, and resurrection, that we have a Lord that has defeated both sin and death, and that he has risen. And he is seated at the right hand of Father Almighty, interceding for us. Dear Lord, we thank you. Not only we ask that you bless this offering, but bless each and every one here today. Dear Lord, bless those that are able to give financially. Bless those that are able to pray. Bless those that are able to serve. And dear Lord, we thank you as you bless each and every one for their presence. Minister to each and every heart. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen.
for this morning comes from John chapter 13, verses 1 through 17. I'll be reading from the NRSV. If you'd like to follow along with your pew Bibles, it's on page 131 in the New Testament. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who is bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. You are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him, and for this reason he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, he put on his robe and had returned to the table. He said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord. You are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you should also do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thank you, Courtney. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, we all desire for our life to have purpose. Dear Lord, we look for purpose in many different places. And yet, Jesus, you showed us what that purpose is. And I pray today that we allow you to continually lead us and guide us and direct us, that we would use our gifts or talents to share that love with others. Dear Lord, that we would care for one another, that we would pray for one another, that we would forgive one another, and dear Lord, that we would serve. Because dear Lord, we're not doing anything that you haven't already showed us. We're not doing anything that you wouldn't do. So I just thank you again for this time. Ask you for the words, that they'd be your words and not mine, because your words never return void. Hide me behind the cross of Jesus, so they'd see you and not me. These things we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. You know, we're all looking for purpose. We're all looking for purpose. And so that wasn't something new in Jesus' time. We know three different occasions we see where they were looking for purpose. And one of them was when James and John came to Jesus in Mark 10, verses 35 through 45. It said, "Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him, saying, 'Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask.'" Does that kind of sound familiar? I guess things haven't changed in 2,000 years. "We want you to do for what we're asking for."
And he said to them, "What do you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us that we may sit, one on your right hand and the other on your left hand, in your glory." But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you ask. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" They said to him, "We are able." So Jesus said to them, "You will indeed drink the cup that I drink, and with the baptism I am baptizing you with, you will be baptized. But to sit on my right hand and on my left hand is not mine to give, but it is for those for whom it is prepared." And when the 10 heard it, the other disciples heard what James and John asked for, they began to be greatly displeased with James and John. Not that they asked, but because they would probably ask the same, right? But Jesus called them to himself and said to them, "You know that those who are considered rulers over the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. Yet it shall not be among you. But whoever desires to become great among you shall be your servant. And whoever of you desires to be first shall be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give life a ransom for many." They wanted to sit next to Jesus when he came into glory. Those positions were they're very significant. They're very significant of honor and authority. And the brothers thought, you know, we'd like that. Actually, they even asked their mama to do it. That's another part in the gospel, but their own mother even said, "Jesus, could my boys sit on your left hand and right hand?" We can see why the other disciples were quite upset. But Jesus told them to drink the cup that they would drink or be baptized with the baptism were metaphors for enduring suffering. James was executed and John was exiled. But whoever wants to become great indicates Jesus didn't quench the disciples' desire for greatness. He didn't say wanting to be great was a bad thing. But to be great, you must be a servant. What he was saying, it isn't as the world sees to be great. But according to God's word, that we are to become a servant. According to Paul, believers are called to serve one another through love. And we see that in Galatians 5:13. God saves us by grace, apart from good works. But in Christ, we are created for good works. We see this in Ephesians 2:8-10. So once we are saved, it's time to get to work. Once we have been saved, we are to get to work. To practice servanthood among the people of God is to serve others with no strings attached. Many times we live in a world, well, if I do this for you, then you should do that for me. But there's no strings attached. We do this for the glory of God. The Church of Jesus Christ is a family, and we're called to serve each other. Jesus didn't call his disciples to walk a path that he wouldn't walk. To serve was the reason that he came into the world. Paul exhorts the Philippians to reject selfish ambition. He tells them that they should live with humility and to be concerned for the interest of others. We see that in Philippians 2:3-4. In fact, he puts Christ as the example, how we are to live, that we would live a selfless, a loving, a God-honoring service. As John put it, the one who remains in Christ should walk just as he walked in 1 John 2:6. We also see Peter. Peter was always ready to speak. They said his mouth might have been shaped like a foot, or he wear peppermint socks. I can relate to Peter. And he loved comparing himself to others. As I told the children of what we read in John 13, we know from Luke, they were actually talking among one another. They was wanting the best seat. Who's going to sit by Jesus? I can even hear Peter saying, well, which any of you have walked on water? Forgot to mention that he was sinking, but which of you? I'm the only one here around this table. And then there was Judas. He was about to turn Jesus over to the religious leaders for 30 pieces of silver. And why was he doing this? What was Judas's motivation? Was it a need for recognition? Was it craving for power? Or longing for respect? Maybe that he would line himself up with the religious leaders? Or maybe it was less complex. Maybe he just wanted money. The Passover meal from John 13. It was a celebration over 1,200 years. It was a 7-day celebration after 400 years of slavery. God sent 9 plagues that the Pharaoh would let the people go, but they didn't. But on the 10th plague, they did. The 10th plague was the angel of death would come over the land of Egypt, that they were to take a lamb, a spotless lamb, that they would slaughter, that they would take the blood and put it over the door so the angel of death would pass over. You see, they were celebrating for what God had done and had freed them. And we know that the disciples wanted to be recognized. They felt their purpose was to be either on the left or on the right of Jesus. None of them that evening had washed the feet of anyone else. See, this was to be left for either a slave or the lowest of servants. And Jesus loved them. And I know he wanted to teach them and tell them. But he had to show them what he had been showing them the 3 years. About he was called to serve, not to be served. They were called to serve. So he took his outer garment off. He put a towel on. I imagine they wasn't even watching what Jesus was doing. They were just so concerned about what seat that they were about 3 seats. And Jesus went and washed their feet. And he didn't discriminate against any of them. Even Judas, who was about to sell him out for 30 pieces of silver. So he washed the feet of the one that would betray him. He washed the feet of those that would, as soon as things got difficult, they would abandon him, just as he told. And the one that was about to deny him. Even though he was ready to say and did say, boy, the rest of them you deny you, but not me, Lord. You can trust me, is what Peter said. You can count on me. And Jesus said, yes, I am teacher, yes, I am Lord. And I have gave you an example of purpose, of washing one another's. It wasn't the greatest thing. Like I said, it was the least of things. But how important each person is. And that they would have that example. When they saw someone in the dirt of life, when they saw someone in problems, they would come beside them and they would care for them just as Jesus cared for them. J. Wallace Hamilton. Many of you have heard that name because you watched the video this morning. He gives us a true example during the Great Depression. That men were given jobs to, they were hired to build a road. They had the equipment, they had the resources to build a road. I imagine they were so excited that they had employment, that they would be able to take care of their family. But very, very soon they found out that road that they were building led to nowhere. It led to nowhere. It had no purpose. They said their morale and production declined where it was nothing. You know, roads that lead to nowhere are hard to build. Let me say that again. Roads that lead to nowhere are very hard to build. So where do we go for purpose? Is it wealth or is it power? Is a position. They say, I remember one comedian once said, I think it was Paula Poundstone once said, that's why adults ask children at the ages of 3 what they want to be when they grow up, to give us some ideas. Well, I thought it was funny. But, okay, I should have cued you earlier. But Jesus shares with us the purpose of serving. How important it is to serve. Because we're going to come across people that are hurting, that are broken, that needed to be lifted up, that we are to come beside them and help them. And nothing is too small. Jesus wouldn't ask us to do anything that He wouldn't do. He came along people that other people wouldn't even talk to, that other people wouldn't even associate with. And He cared for them. And He loved them. And we're called to do the same. Today, they're said that depression is 3 times greater than what our grandparents faced. Because our focus on self leads to depression. Because when we start focusing on ourselves, it leads to depression. But when we focus on others, we discover purpose. I remember once that my son was mowing a lawn for a lady. She was in her 80s and she had cancer, and it was a slow-growing cancer. She was in her 80s and she needed knee replacement. She's in her 80s and she got both knees replaced at the same time. And I was talking to her later after she had her knees replaced. And she always loved going out in the garden or in her yard and pulling out weeds. And she said, you know what? My mother-in-law taught me, when I'm digging in the dirt and I'm in my knees, that's probably when I'm closest to God. And I can start thinking of others and caring for others and praying for others. I thought, my, here she is in her 80s and dealing with cancer, and now she's had surgery and she's lifting others up. Talk about serving. Talk about serving. So what road are you on? What road are you on? You know, it's human nature to follow selfish pursuits. But that road that leads nowhere is very hard. That road that leads to nowhere is very hard. But the way of Jesus, we're made for this. We're made to serve. We're made to care for others. You've been gifted. You've been wired. Each one of you uniquely been wired and gifted and have been given talents. I was reminded this week of one of the talents that I do not have. It's singing. At that time, Murray thought, you know, he had another engagement, but he stayed behind and filmed and ran the soundboard and everything for the funeral yesterday. But earlier, before he knew that there were going to be so many gone, that he was going to be able to get away. And he said, now, Dennis, I've turned your mic up a little bit louder than normal, but I've also turned their mic up so when it's recorded, we'll be able to hear the congregation sing. So I just want you to lip the song. And then Murray, honest, the family said, why didn't you sing very loud? I said, because Murray told me to lip sync. Amen. Hallelujah, right? Yeah. But when we do the way of Jesus, when we humble ourselves and we think of others and we care for others, I guess that was caring for others, me not singing out loud, Murray. But being that servant and to serve one another. What a blessing that is. We've been made for this. Let us do it. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we want our life to have a purpose. And that purpose is to care for others, to love one another, to serve one another, just as Jesus has loved us. Jesus came to serve, and he came to save. We're about to receive communion today because that Passover meal is much different. For that 1,200 years, they reflected on how God had led them out of Egypt. How he had released them out of slavery. And Jesus also wanted to know that he was that path. He was the Lamb. He was the Lamb of God. That he came to save us. That he was going to shed his blood. That we would be forgiven. That our sins would have been paid for. So dear Lord, just continue to minister to each one of our hearts. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Now at this time, would my communion stewards please come forward? And as they prepare themselves and wash their hands, I'll prepare the elements. When I think of communion, because this is the Lord's table in the United Methodist Church, it's open communion, it's for all people. But I think of the disciples. That very first time, Jesus took the bread and broke it. Blessed and broke it and said, this is my body. Take, eat, and do this in remembrance of me. I think of the disciples that was ready to abandon him, ready to betray him, ready to deny him. And I've done all those things also. But he said, receive my body. He's letting them know what he is going to do for them. And that we would reflect and do it ourselves. And remember that we are forgiven. And then after the meal, there was four cups, four promises, and The third one was the cup of redemption, and Jesus took it and blessed it. He said, this is a new covenant, my blood shed for the forgiveness of your sins. Take, drink, and do this in remembrance of me. Let us pray. Gracious God, we come before you today. And we just thank you as you bless these elements, this bread and this juice. It reminds us this is your body and this is your blood shed for our sins. Dear Lord, we all need a Savior. You are a Savior. Minister to each and every heart. Strengthen them, empower them, and let them know that they are loved, that they are forgiven. We thank you again for this special time. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Then we'll receive communion after we're over. After we've given communion to everyone else. So would you please come in this invitation? You can either dip in the cup or take from a cup. Would you please come and receive?
Thank you and praise you. Minister to each and every heart. Dear Lord, we thank you for what you have done, what you are doing in our lives, that one day we will be with you again. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. God bless you all. Now at this time, if you're comfortable standing, I'm going to ask you to stand as we sing hymn number 432, Jesus, Jesus.
Gracious God, we thank you and praise you. Dear Lord, as we have you as an example, dear Jesus, that we would reach out, that we would care, that we would love, that we would serve. And dear Lord, I just thank you. I just praise you, knowing that how you use service to transform us. Dear Lord, that we would think of others, that we would look at their interest before ours. So, dear Lord, I just send them out in your service. I send them out in the power of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. God bless you all.